in the New Testament. And we'll read from verse 15 to the end of the chapter. Just three verses, the writings of the Apostle Paul. This is the word of the Lord. "And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." Well, our subject is the divine inspiration of the Holy Scriptures, a very important subject, as I'm sure you'll appreciate when we're done. Revelation, that is God's revealing of himself, giving us his word, the Bible, is essentially an act of God. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 11, "For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the spirit of God." If a man does not reveal to you what he's thinking, there's no way that you can know what he's thinking. You may guess, you may have an opinion, but you don't really know unless he reveals it to you. Likewise with God, unless God speaks, unless the Spirit of God reveals to us the mind of God, there is no way that we can know what the mind of God is. So without God, God is unknown. But he has chosen to reveal himself supernaturally and infallibly through his word, through the revelation of Holy Scripture, the divinely inspired word of God. Without the Bible, we must start with the Bible, because without the Bible, the term, the name God, is a wax nose. You could press it into any shape you like, into an Islamic shape, a Buddhist shape, Roman Catholic shape, any shape you like. Yeah. The Westminster Confession has an excellent chapter on the Bible, on the Holy Scriptures. And it begins, chapter one, it begins, of course, with the Word of God. Because it's the Word of God that reveals to us what God is truly like. Although the light of nature and the works of creation and providence do so far manifest the goodness, wisdom, and power of God as to leave men unexcusable, yet are they not sufficient to give that knowledge of God and of his will which is necessary unto salvation. Therefore it pleased the Lord at sundry times and in divers manners to reveal himself and to declare that his will unto his church, and afterwards for the better preserving and propagating of the truth, and for the more sure establishment and comfort of the church against the corruption of the flesh and the malice of Satan and of the world, to commit the same wholly unto writing, which maketh the Holy Scripture to be most necessary. Those former ways of God's revealing his will unto his people being now ceased." So the word of God, you see, the Bible, the divinely inspired word of God, is essential, is necessary. Without it, we cannot know what God is like. Man is just left to fumble about in the universe. He has nature. He has God's created order. The voice of God in man's conscience, God's moral agent within man, of course, that excuses or excuses him. There is a desire in man for justice, feelings of guilt, and so therefore a need for expiation, that is, atonement for his sins. But without the word of God, you see, these means, man's conscience, his desire for justice, his need for expiation, he looks at God's creation, he looks at nature, but that does not reveal God to him. does not bring to him the justice he desires, does not bring to him the expiation, the forgiveness that he needs. So what does he do? He either seeks salvation by man or by the modern day civilized pagan worship of self. He's lost. He's wholly warped. He's left wandering about in God's universe, not knowing where he came from, his purposes here in God's universe. Nature, conscience, reason, all shot through with sin, and therefore cannot lead him to God and to a true relationship with God. So another revelation is needed, an inspired revelation, an infallible revelation, a revelation that we know, we are assured is from God, that we can trust, and of course that will instruct us in the way of righteousness and bring man back to God. So when we use the word inspired, as Paul does here in 2 Timothy, the inspiration of Scripture, he's talking about the determining influence of the person of the Holy Spirit upon the writers of Scripture, that is the men, the human authors of the Bible. 2 Peter 1 verse 19, Peter says, "We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost." These authors were human, they remained human, and of course they were themselves. You look at Paul's writings and you say, yes, that's Paul, we understand, we know Paul, and yes, that's Peter, he's a different man altogether. The Holy Spirit takes these human authors and so influences them in what they are writing, have written, that what we have is the divinely inspired Holy Scriptures, the Word of God, the Bible. So our first point this evening is the necessity, the need for this divinely inspired Scripture. The connection with God and man was broken by the fall. Our first parent, Adam, not Eve, Adam. Sin came by Adam. Adam sinned, and he brought sin, he brought death, he brought suffering, he brought the whole mess. The connection with God was broken as a result of Adam's sin. But there remains in man, all men, an innate knowledge of God. Some men call themselves atheists, secularists, evolutionists, but the truth of the matter is, God says, all men know that God is. But men hold, suppress that truth in unrighteousness. And of course, without the Scriptures, the necessary Scriptures, without the revelation of God, man cannot find himself. He knows that there is a God, although he suppresses the truth, but he cannot find God in nature, in God's created order. Because that too, because of man's sin, is marred, is imperfect. He looks at creation, he looks at the mountains, he looks at the stars, the seas, the rivers, the plants, but he sees there only the divine attributes, the power and the divinity of the Godhead, but he cannot see the moral perfections, he cannot see the mercy, the compassion, he cannot see the love, he cannot see the redemption of God. And of course, he does not even know or understand his own being. So the word of God is profitable to this end, Paul tells us in verse 15 of 2 Timothy chapter 3. The word of God is profitable to reprove, to correct, to instruct us in righteousness, that is to bring us into a righteous standing with a holy and righteous God. It's the Scriptures, you see, the divine Scriptures that are necessary to alter a man's destiny heavenward, to alter his character, and of course to bring him into the way of righteousness. Nature, you see, in itself is insufficient, but yet still it leaves man without any excuse, God says in Romans chapter 1. It gives him no intimate knowledge of God, it does not reveal to him the will of God, and it does not reveal to him the salvation of God. In Romans 1 and verse 19, Paul says, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. It only reveals the attributes of God. It only reveals the displeasure, the wrath of God. In fact, nature, in fact, the created order, testifies to man's fallen state and condition. Genesis 3, verse 17, unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it, curses the ground for thy sake, in sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field, in the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread till thou return unto the ground. For out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust thou shalt return. In all creation, all the created order, nature itself as we call it, testifies to man's fallenness, his sin. A man goes to Australia, he swims in the water, a shark, a crocodile bites him, devours him. He's flying across the Atlantic Ocean, a lightning bolt strikes the aircraft and it plunges into the Atlantic Ocean. All of creation is hostile. Man's whole environment is hostile because of man's sin. It's violent even, testifying to the revealed wrath of God against man because of man's sin. Testifying that we are all of us sinners. But then man's reason too, you see. Well, you see, surely a man can reason, he can rationalize, and he can think his way back to God. Well, Job says no. Job chapter 11, verse 7, canst thou by searching find out God? Canst thou find out the Almighty unto perfection? And of course, the answer to Job's questions is no. Because the result of sin also in man is that of irrationality. The fool says in his heart, there is no God, Psalm 14, verse 1. Not when the psalmist says that man is a fool, he doesn't mean he's not smart. Oh yes, he can send rockets to the moon, he can invent medicines that heal men's bodies and minds, or he can do all kinds of wonderful things. He is morally corrupt, the psalmist means. He's a fool in that sense, ethically speaking. Because what he does is he holds the truth in unrighteousness. Romans 1:18, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold down, that is, hold the truth in unrighteousness, suppress the truth in unrighteousness. He knows that there is a God, but he doesn't want there to be a God because he's fallen, because the wrath of God is against him. He does not want to acknowledge. He cannot find God for the same reason a thief can't find a policeman. He doesn't want to. Let me give you an illustration. Father takes his children to the beach, and out comes the beach ball. Daddy gets in the water. He sits on the beach ball, and he presses it, he suppresses it down into the water, and he shouts to all the kids, where's the beach ball? Where's the beach ball? Of course, the kids know he's playing the fool. He knows where the ball is, and so do they. He's holding it down in the water. But in order to keep it under the water, he has to work hard to keep it down because that ball wants to keep pushing up again. In like fashion, you see, the atheist, so-called, sinful man in his natural condition is likewise suppressing the truth of the knowledge of God in unrighteousness. He's holding it down. He's a fool. He knows that God is there, but he keeps suppressing that truth. But of course, it keeps popping back up. There are times when it's when God, you know, the subject comes to his mind, a bereavement, he's faced with death, a sickness or something, his conscience. He has to work hard at suppressing the truth of the knowledge of God, which he has innately. So, natural man, you see, in his irrationality, he looks at the universe. You as a believer, you look at it. You look at the universe, you look at the stars in the sky, and you say, wow, yeah, there is a God. You know, this is God's universe. But natural fallen man, he looks at the universe and he interprets it differently. He interprets it in terms of an egocentric philosophy of man, such as evolution. Because he would rather glorify man than God. His reason, you see, is paralyzed. And all his human systems of philosophy fail him, and he's left with his broken, fallen reason and no way back to God. But God has spoken. God has spoken. In various ways, in past times, Hebrews 11, verse 1, God, who at sundry times in divers manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things. And this is the record, the divinely inspired scriptures, is the record that God has given to us of his Son, Jesus Christ. Preserving and propagating the truth. Preserving the truth, the written word of God, down through the generations, even till this time. And propagating the truth throughout the world with his servants proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ. And all this against the flesh, as the Westminster Confession says, against the flesh, against the world, against Satan. God has chosen, it has pleased God to commit the same, that is his revelation, his written revelation, wholly unto writing, the revelation that was needed for man, that was absolutely necessary for us to come to an intimate, loving, right relationship with the true and living God. A revelation. Divinely inspired scriptures that depend not upon the testimony of men, but God himself, because he ultimately is the author, and the scriptures of God are to be revealed as they are, as his written word. Secondly, the need for an inspired holy scripture. To deny that the Bible, the Holy Scriptures, are the inspired Word of God leaves you with no ultimate standard and with no supreme authority. I mean, what would the ultimate standard be? That of the government? Or which government? The US government? The Russian government? The British government? What would the ultimate standard for ethics, in fact, for anything be? Your standard, your family, my family, your opinion, my opinion? You're left with no ultimate standard, and you're left with no supreme authority. It just plunges man back into a sea of doubt once again, wondering which authority is the supreme one. But the inspiration of the Holy Scriptures, you see, is a mysterious act of the Holy Spirit of God as he fills and as he guides, as he overrules and superintends the writers, the human authors, causing them to write that which God required them to write. Not taking them and using them as automatons, or secretaries just simply taking notes. But the Holy Spirit works upon these men who gave us the scriptures so that what they wrote and what arose from them is in fact the inspired, infallible, sacred book that we have before us this evening, the Bible, the Word of God. It is called, in theological terms, the plenary inspired scriptures of God. The word plenary, it means fully God's word. It means completely. It is all God's word. It, in its entirety, it is God's word. It is absolutely, it is unqualifiedly God's word. Verse 16 of 2 Timothy 3, all scripture, he says, from Genesis right through to Revelation, the first word to the last word, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. And of course, at the end of the book of Revelation, we are given a warning there. For I testify unto you, says the Apostle John, unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, and out of the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book. Providentially, at the very end of the Bible, but it stands as the warning against anyone who would corrupt or who would oppose or who would deny the inspired, divinely inspired Holy Scriptures that God has given to us. Jesus assures us in Matthew 24 and verse 35, he says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. All of it, divinely inspired, all scripture, it's all God's word. And it will endure, it has endured the test of time until this time, and will do till the end of the age, and it will endure the test of eternity. Over against all the wisdom of men, all the cleverness of man in the world put together. Every book in the world could be destroyed but the Bible, and we would not have lost one single ounce of truth. We have all the truth that God requires us to have in his word, in the Bible, the divinely inspired scriptures. But then when we say inspiration, we mean not only plenary inspiration, but we mean verbal inspiration. The very words, the very letters, the punctuation, history, dates, names, all inspired of God. You have a wonderful example in Isaiah chapter 45 and verse 1, where God there, hundreds of years before the man is even born, names the man Cyrus. Correct. Not yet born, but yet God names him and even appoints him. He tells us he will be, following on from the Babylonian Empire, he will be the next world ruler. Isaiah chapter 45 and verse 1, thus saith the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have holden to subdue nations before him. You can change. You can make a sentence, and you can change one letter in that sentence, and you can give the sentence a whole different meaning. So it's important, you see, when it comes to divine inspiration, that we understand, that we know that there are no mistakes in it. Not even in a translation. When we talk about inspiration of the Holy Scriptures, people say, that's the original. That's the original, that's the Hebrew and Greek, yes. Yes, it is. But also a translation, because an honest, sincere translation of the original scriptures is still the word of God. And so when we hold in our hands our authorized version of the Bible, which I do believe myself is a much superior translation to all the rest, but You are assured that you still have the inspired word of God. Verbal, literal, the inerrant word of God. Even the silences are inspired. Because where God is silent, we too remain silent. He has given to us all that we need in Holy Scripture. But then the unity of the Scriptures, the unity of the Bible points to the fact that it is divinely inspired. For there are no contradictions in the Word of God. Different writers writing in different ages. You've got Moses at the beginning, and you've got the Apostle John at the end, and many, many men in between, different ages, different backgrounds, different characters, some different cultures, writing about the same matters, same incidents, some of them, and yet there are no discrepancies, none whatsoever. There's a harmony, there's a cohesion throughout the whole thing. The whole thing just holds together with the glue of God's holy inspiration. There's a harmony throughout. You, humanly speaking, you have 37 different authors, writers, throughout the Bible. And yet they all agree. You never find one of them arguing against the other. You never hear Paul saying, well, I don't agree with Moses here. You never hear the Apostle John saying, well, I don't agree with Isaiah, what he said there. They all agree with matters relating to the being of God, the being of man, man's sinfulness and his great need of salvation. They all agree. There's harmony throughout the whole book. That's supernatural, beloved. That's supernatural. You take 37 men from Stoke-on-Trent here, you bring them into one building, put them all into different rooms and give them one single subject to write about. Just one page, and you bring them all together, I guarantee you, knowing human nature, you will not get one agreeing with the other. But the Bible is divinely inspired. It is a supernatural book. It is a miracle in itself. The Bible authenticates itself, testifies to itself, to its divine origin. It is the Word of God. The divinely inspired, inscripturated Word of God. But thirdly and finally, the Apostle Paul, he tells us of the profitability of the Scriptures. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable, he says. Profitable, that is, for doctrine, for teaching. Profitable, that is, for reproof, to tell us off when we need to be told off, because oftentimes we do. For correction, because we're not always on the right pathway, and for instruction in righteousness. They have the ability, Paul tells us, able to make us wise, not clever, because the simplest of men, the simplest, even a child could understand. In fact, perhaps maybe that's what Jesus means when he says, except you be converted and become like as children, you shall no wise enter the kingdom of heaven. We need that simplistic childlike trust in what God says, what God has spoken in his word, you see, to take him at his word, to trust him. Able to make us wise unto salvation. We have got here in the divinely inspired Scriptures, we have got everything, all that is needful for us to glorify God, all that is needful for man's salvation, all that is necessary for faith, what we have to believe. You say, what have we to believe? This is what you are to believe, the Word of God. All that we need for life. Set down plainly, again, as the Westminster Confession tells us, set down plainly in Holy Scripture, or is deduced therefrom. But this is the baseline. This is the final court of appeal in all matters concerning religion, man's affairs with God. It's the supreme judge in controversies. This is how they're determined. This is how they're sorted out. The decrees of councils and synods, the opinions of writers and private spirits, all come secondary to the Word of God. Where there's a disagreement between two Christians, how do you sort it out? The Word of God is the supreme judge. There's a war going on in a denomination, in a church. How do you sort it out? Who has the final word? This is the supreme judge. The Word of God, the inspired, holy scripture of God. Everything is to be brought to the touchstone of the Word of God. God has spoken. Hear, O heavens, give ear, O earth. The Lord has spoken. Isaiah says, chapter 1. God has spoken, and God has the last word. Contrary, for example, to the Roman Catholic Church, who says, oh yes, the Bible is fine, but we are the interpreters of it. We tell you what it says. We tell you what it means. We tell you where you're to obey it. No, 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 no. It is the Word of God that is the supreme judge, not the church, not any church. You think of all the controversies going on in the Church of England at this time, all the wars that are being fought in synods and councils. How does it come to an end? How is it resolved? The supreme judge is the inspired scriptures, is the Word of God. That's the baseline. If that is only that men would believe the Word of God and receive the Word of God and come to the Word of God and obey the Word of God. Our consciences, you see, the consciences of all men are bound by the Word of God, whether men believe or not. And it's by the Word of God our consciences, you see, are informed. Sometimes our consciences can be wrong. Sometimes we can be suffering from feelings and thoughts of guilt when we're not guilty at all. And sometimes our consciences are at peace when they should not be at peace. So our consciences, you see, are to be educated, are to be instructed from and by the Word of God. It's our ultimate standard in conduct. How to get right with God? How does a man get right with God? That's the $64 million question. How does a man get right with God? The Bible gives him the answer. Believe. Trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. What do I do? What do I have to do to be saved? The answer is given in the ultimate standard for our conduct, the Word of God, the inscripturated Word of God. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. How does the guilty soul find peace? The answer is given to us here. Peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through faith in his name. How is a Christian? How do I live a life that is pleasing to God? By what standard? What if the state says the opposite? The Word of God. It is better to obey God than to obey men. The Word of God is the ultimate standard for conduct. Whatever the state says, whatever the church says, whatever anybody says, the Word of God is the ultimate standard. By this standard we shall be judged. This is our chart to guide us over the ocean of time to our eternal destiny, to the safety of heaven. But of course, if we have Bibles and we pay no heed to them, then we are totally without excuse. But here, I suggest to you, is a sure foundation for your faith. Men, do they not crave certainty? I want to be sure. I want to be absolutely sure this is right. Well, the Bible tells us, instructs us, that we can know God. We can know him intimately. We can know him. We can have full assurance of faith. We can have the knowledge that we have passed from death to life. We can have the knowledge that we are right with God and that we are on the pathway to heaven, to eternal glory. We can know that our Redeemer liveth. We can know that He is alive from the dead. We can know that we have passed from death to life, says the Apostle John. And this is life eternal, that they might know Thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom Thou hast sent. How? Because the Bible tells me so. Because the Bible tells us so. We want, friends, and we need no more than the divinely inspired scriptures of God that speak with absolute assurance, that speak dogmatically, and that speak with finality. This, my friends, is an impregnable rock, because it is from God, every single word of it. Thus saith the Lord. And that should be enough for us. That should be enough for us to study and to meditate upon the pages of the divinely inspired scriptures is the best course in theology, in religion, that I could recommend to anyone. See, ye refuse not him that speaks. But of course, ultimately, the Bible reveals to us the one who is the golden thread that weaves its way through the entirety of the Bible, the living Word of God, even our Lord Jesus Christ, the one who is ultimately to be the object of our faith, and the one in whom alone is salvation, the only mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. These are written that you might believe, that you might believe. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Written, the means by which a man can come to faith, to trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and know that he is right with God and know that he is safe for time and for eternity in the arms of Jesus, the only Savior. Study the Word of God. Meditate upon the Word of God. Believe the Word of God. It is a book to live with, and it is a book to die with. Sir Walter Scott, the Scottish novelist, he said, on his deathbed, he said to his friends, "Read me out of the book." His friends asked him, they said, "What book do you mean?" He says, "There's only one," he said, "the Bible. It is a book to live by, and it is a book to die by. The divinely inspired scriptures of God." Inspired of God, profitable, profitable for us in every which way, for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfectly, thoroughly furnished, decked out with everything, everything, all that he needs for the good works that God has called us to perform in this world. Amen.